Last week we asked the question, is faith enough? An interesting question that might seem to need some qualifying, but we saw that we are certainly saved by grace through faith, Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8. We saw that we become the children of God by faith, Galatians chapter 3 and verse 26. We learned that it is the prayer of faith that saves the sick, James chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. We saw that Jesus says that He is the author and finisher of our faith through the Apostle Paul in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2. Jesus said that faith is so strong that if we have but just a grain of mustard seed, we can tell this mountain to be moved into the ocean, and it will. And also that according to Romans 12:3, God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Sounds pretty good, doesn't it? I'd like to invite you to turn to Romans chapter 3 and verse 20 as we just continue a few thoughts here along this line. Romans chapter 3 and verse 20. The Apostle Paul writes, "Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin." And in chapter 4, verse 2, Paul says, "For if Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before God." Verse 3, "For what saith the Scriptures? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness." Verse 4, "Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt." And now if we would turn to Galatians chapter 2 and verse 16. Galatians chapter 2 and verse 16. He says, "Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law." But in the Greek, the definite article is not there. In other words, he says, you are not justified by the works of law, not works of any kind of law, not any kind of works. These cannot justify us. He says, but, not by works of law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of law, for by the works of law shall no flesh be justified. That's the Greek reading of it. So what is this thing that we call works? Works is certainly not an identical twin to faith. But is it an evil twin? A fraternal twin? Can works be something complementary to faith, or rather something that stands in contradistinction to faith? We also learned last week that faith works by love and purifies the soul. So are works enough? We asked the question last week, is faith enough? But today we're asking the question, are works enough? Well, let's just see some things the Bible says about works, though. Let's turn to some of the very words of Jesus. When we think about Jesus, friends, we think about the author and finisher of our what?
Faith.
And we think about Jesus as being an authority on salvation, don't we? If anyone understands about salvation, it should be Jesus. Isn't that right? I'll start in verse 16. "Behold, one came and said unto him, Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?" Verse 17. "And he said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. If thou wilt enter into life," have a lot of faith. Well, I thought the Bible taught salvation by grace through faith, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. But Jesus said, if you will enter into life, He says, keep the commandments. No, maybe he didn't say that. I probably read it wrong. If thou wilt enter into life, wait a minute, keep the commandments. That's what it says. It does say that. In Matthew chapter 7, Jesus said something else. Matthew chapter 7, verse 16. He says, "Ye shall know them by their fruits." By their fruits. We'll know whether these people are believers, they are followers of Jesus or not, by their fruits. And fruits are connected to your works, to the things you do. In Matthew chapter 5, also in the Sermon on the Mount, verses 17 and 18, Jesus said, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled." Well, last time I went out and looked, there's a lot of ground out there. What about you? Well, James spoke about this too. We should see something that James said. James chapter 2, verses 14 through 20. James says, "For what doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and hath not works? Can faith save him?" Well, yes, of course faith saves us. It says we're saved by faith. We read that last week, didn't we? We're saved by grace through faith. Jesus said about Mary, her faith has saved her. He said about blind Bartimaeus, his faith had saved him and made him whole. James says, he asks the question, can faith save him? "If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food," verse 16, "and one of you saying to them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doth it profit? Even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone." Verse 18, "Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Shew me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works. Thou believest that there is one God. Thou doest well." Do all of you believe there's one true God?
Amen.
Did Jesus say there's one true God in John 17:3? Yep. Oh, you do well, right? That's what James says. You do well. But he says the devils also believe and tremble. Verse 20, "But wilt thou know, vain man, that faith without works is dead." So if there is something called faith, true faith, friends, it has to have works with it. It has to work. It has to work by love. And then it will purify our soul. Well, why we're here in James chapter 2 and verse 8, James says, "If ye fulfill the royal law according to the scriptures, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, ye do well." So we do well when we do that. When we follow the second great commandment. And James calls it here what? The royal law. In James chapter 1 and verse 25, "But whosoever looketh into the perfect law of liberty," and then forgets it and just believes in faith. Does it say that? "But whosoever looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed." So he says that we look into the perfect law of liberty. It's a law not of bondage, it's a law of liberty, he says. And he says that we are to continue therein. Proverbs chapter 29, verse 18 now. Proverbs 29, 18. You know where Proverbs is? That's right after what book?
Psalms,
that's right. Proverbs 29 and verse 18. "Where there is no," what?
Vision.
"Vision, the people perish, but he that has a lot of faith is the happy one." What does the text say? "But he that keepeth the law, happy is he." But I thought keeping the law was like a work. What is a work? But it's a very good work. And it says those who do this are happy. Well, we're not done. Acts chapter 5, verse 32. You know this text probably. Acts chapter 5, verse 32. Peter says, "And we are his witnesses of these things, and so is also the Holy Ghost," or the Holy Spirit, "whom God hath given to them that," what?
Obey him.
Obey him. That's right. Well, maybe we should go to the book of Revelation. There's a lot in Revelation, so maybe we should look at a couple texts. And we'll just look at a couple in Revelation 22, for example. Revelation chapter 22, verse 7. "Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book." There's a blessing on those who obey, who walk in the works and the things that are said therein. Revelation 22, verse 14 now. "Blessed are they that do his commandments." that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. And I know if you have a newer translation based upon one of the corrupt manuscripts, it says something different. But the King James, based on the Textus Receptus, says, blessed are they that do his commandments. And that is a fact. You know what Romans chapter 7, verse 12 says? It says, the law is holy, the commandment holy, and just and good. Romans 7:12. And Psalms 119 and verse 172, he says, all thy commandments are righteousness. And one more text, Ecclesiastes chapter 12. And when I say one more text, I mean one more text on this section. We certainly are not done. We can't leave ourselves in this conundrum we're in. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verses 13 and 14. He says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Well, that might be a good text to end everything on, but we're not going to use it as our concluding text today. But he says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. I would think that probably everything we've read this morning, mostly, after we got started, at least in this section, all those Jews in the time of Jesus would probably have said amen to every one of them. They liked this. Pretty good. Because they were majoring in works and what they could accomplish and how that they could earn their salvation by doing these things. And they came to Jesus one day and they asked him about this question. If we turn to John chapter 6, we'll see it. John chapter 6 and verse 28. Then they said unto him, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? Now notice they want to do something. They want to work, and they want to work the works, that's plural, isn't it, of God. So we want to do works. We want to do the right works. We want to do the works God has for us. Do you think Jesus had an answer? Of course Jesus had an answer. Verse 29. Jesus answered and said unto them, this is the work of God, that ye believe on him whom he hath sent. Now he says that ye believe. Believe means to have faith, right? Believe comes from the Greek word pistuo, which is a root word. It's a verb. It means to believe, to have faith. Pistis is the Greek word for faith. It's simply the noun form of pistuo, the verb. So he says, this is the work, that you believe or that you have faith on him whom he has sent. Now, who is the he that sent someone? The Father. And who did he send? His Son, Jesus Christ. That's very, very clear. When you think about in Galatians chapter 5, and you read that great portion of Galatians where Paul speaks about the fruit of the Spirit and the works of flesh, it's a singular fruit of the Spirit, but it's a plural works of the flesh. You can read about the works of the flesh in Galatians 5, verses 19 through 22. I won't take time to read it, but you are familiar with it. But there he speaks about the works of the flesh, and they are numerous. But how are we to believe in Jesus? How are we to live this life? You know, it sounds like we must have faith. It sounds like we must have works. One sounds as if it's exclusive to the other at times. But there's a text in Colossians chapter 2 and verse 6 I'd like for you to notice. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 6. And in fact, I'm going to go back and just read verse 3, 4, and 5 also. Because I want you to see the context of something that Paul is trying to make very clear here. Speaking about of the Father in Christ, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, verse 4, and this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. So what I'm telling you now is something important I don't want you to be deceived by. I'm making this clear so that you won't be beguiled. 5, for though I be absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in the Spirit, joying and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. Now, Paul had been laboring for the church in Colossae, and he had brought people to Jesus there, and he said that they were to be steadfast in their faith in Christ. And how had they received Jesus? They received him by grace through faith. And now he says, you are to walk in the same way you received Jesus. And that's by grace through faith. Now, we read Romans chapter 3 earlier, but let's go back to Romans 3 and read a little bit more. Romans chapter 3, verse 24. We read verse 20 earlier, remember, by the deeds of law, no flesh is justified. Verse 24, though, it says, being justified, what? How? Freely. Being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Now, do you remember what Acts chapter 5, verse 32 said? God gives the Holy Spirit to those who, what? Obey Him. That's the way we get the Holy Spirit, right? Well, let's read some more. Let's go to Galatians chapter 3 and verse 2. Galatians 3, verse 2. This only would I learn of you. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Wait a minute. He says, you heard the law. You received the Spirit. Did you get this by hearing the law or by receiving it through faith? And the implied answer is very clear. They got this by faith. But I thought Peter said that he gives the Holy Spirit to those who obey him. But if I remember reading James correctly, he says that the way I can know or prove I have faith is by my what?
Works.
By my works. By my works. Now, there's a parallel text in Romans chapter 2 and verse 13 we should see. Romans chapter 2, verse 13, because if we can understand this verse and the principle behind it, it will help bring a lot of this together for us. Romans 2, 13. And it's not that hard. This is not rocket scientists. Verse 13. For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. It says the doers of the law shall be justified. I thought we were saved by grace through faith. Here it says the doers of the law are going to be justified. How do we make this fit together? Because after all, we believe the Bible is a collection of 66 books and many, many chapters and a lot more verses. I don't remember the exact number, but it's a lot. And we believe there's a harmony here. Is that right? Okay. Now, I'll ask you a question. And this is where we get into this idea of exegesis and eisegesis. But let's just look at the text for a minute. Does this text tell us how we are justified? Look at it carefully. Does it say how we are justified? No, it does not. Does it say who will be justified?
Yes.
Oh, yes, it does. It says exactly who will be justified. It says those who are doers of the law, keepers of the law, they're going to be justified, but it doesn't say that's how they get justified. And that we have to be very careful that we don't read something into the text that is not there. This is not the how, but the who. And James says if we have real faith, that real faith works. And those who are doing the law will be the ones justified because they've been justified by faith. And it's only by grace through faith that we can walk with Jesus. Colossians 2:6. Remember, as we receive Jesus, we walk with Him in the same way. You can't obey God's law. You can't keep His commandments. You can't do a single work of any kind of any value without the help and grace of God. In Romans chapter 1, we're close there in verse 5. It says, by whom we have received grace and apostleship. Well, why does He give us grace? Why has He given some apostleship? He goes on to say, for obedience to the faith among all nations for His name. He says that He has given us grace so that we could have obedience. And so our sanctification is a work of faith and grace in our lives. Acts chapter 26 and verse 18, if we could turn there. Acts 26:18. Paul is speaking here to King Agrippa, and he's recounting some of his experience of his conversion. And he says, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by their works. Sanctified by faith that is in me. Jesus says, you're sanctified by faith in me. We think about justification and sanctification. I think, well, you know, when I'm justified, I come to Jesus just as I am, and He helps me, but then I've got to toe the mark after that. Oh, yeah, you do have to toe the mark after that. That's right. You do have to live differently after that. But friends, you can't live differently in your own power. You have to live it by grace through faith, through the power of Jesus. He says, they're sanctified by faith that is in Jesus Christ. If we could go to slide number 3. This is from Manuscript Release, Volume 8, page 357. It was a manuscript Ellen White wrote in 1891, entitled Justified by Faith. She says, the faith that justifies always produces first true repentance and then good works, which are the fruit of that faith. Works are the fruit of faith. Now, Ellen White wasn't only one or the first person ever to say this by any means. Martin Luther preached a whole sermon on works being the fruit of faith. This guy who didn't even like the book of James, he was smart enough to understand that good works were necessary, that they were part of the fruit of our true faith. She says here, the faith that justifies always produces first true repentance and then good works, which are the fruit of that faith. There is no saving faith that does not produce good fruit. God gave Christ to our world to become the sinner's substitute. The moment true faith in the merits of the costly atoning sacrifice is exercised, claiming Christ as a personal Savior, that moment the sinner is justified before God because he is pardoned. And beloved, there is no evidence of genuine repentance unless it works reformation. Remember what John Calvin said? We quoted Calvin last week. Calvin said, it is faith alone which justifies, and yet that faith which justifies is not alone. And so it is faith, and faith alone, that establishes the law of God in the believer's heart and life. In Romans chapter 3, Paul, we've read from Romans 3 a couple times already, and there he says that by the deeds of the law no flesh shall be justified. He says there that we are saved by grace through faith alone. But now, if we come down to the end of chapter 3 in verse 31, he says, he's asking a question, because perhaps this is a question on the minds of those people in the church of Rome he's writing to by this time. Do we then make void the law through faith? And he says, God forbid, yea, we establish the law. We establish the law. True faith establishes the law of God. Romans 6 and verse 2. He's asked the question, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound, in verse 1, and then he says in Romans 6, 2, he says, God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? So, friends, he says, we're not to continue in sin. I want to tell you something. If sin is your nature, you got a problem right now.
That's right.
If sin is your nature, you got a really big problem right now. Because how are you going to continue unless you develop holy flesh? 1 John chapter 5 and verse 3. He says, for this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous. Have you ever had someone say, well, you know, I can't keep the Sabbath? That would be a big hardship on me. I might lose my job, or I couldn't fit in with my family well if I kept the Sabbath. It's grievous to do that. But that's a contradiction to the Word of God. Now, you know, you're welcome to think anything you want. But friends, when you think something contrary to the Word of God, you're calling God a liar. And that's not a good thing. God gives you the freedom to do that. You can call Him a liar to His face if you want to, but I assure you it's not profitable. It says His commandments are not grievous, and I believe it. I do believe it with all my heart. Now, in Romans chapter 8 and verse 7, if we go back to Romans again, chapter 8 and verse 7, there Paul says that the carnal mind, the fleshly mind, the mind that is estranged from Christ, he says it is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So when we do not have Christ, friends, we are at enmity with God, and we can't be subject to Him, to God, and we can't keep His law. But friends, God loved us so much that He sent His only begotten Son to the world, that if we will believe in Him, then we can have eternal life. If we believe in Him, then we can have the mind of Christ, and we don't have to have the mind of the worldliness. Now, the first step in reconciliation to God, as we noted earlier, is certainly a conviction of sin. In Great Controversy, on page 467, paragraph 3, and this comes from, I believe, a chapter called Modern Revivals, and I would suggest you should read that chapter if you haven't read it for a while. It's a really good chapter. But it says, the first step in reconciliation to God is the conviction of sin. Sin is the transgression of the law. By the law is the knowledge of sin, 1 John 3:4 and Romans 3:20. In order to see his guilt, the sinner must test his character by God's great standard of righteousness. It is a mirror which shows the perfection of a righteous character and enables him to discern the defects in his own. The law, it says, the law reveals to man, and this is again from Great Controversy, 467, now paragraph 4, so it's just the next paragraph from the one we just read. It says, the law reveals to man his sins, but it provides no remedy. While it promises life to the obedient, it declares that death is the portion of the transgressor. The gospel of Christ alone can free him from the condemnation or the defilement of sin. He must exercise repentance toward God, whose law has been transgressed, and faith in his atoning sacrifice. Now, just keep your visual eye here, your mind's eye there for a second. We're going to come back to the rest of the statement, but turn with me to Acts chapter 20, verse 21. Why would Ellen White state it quite like she did there? Acts 20, verse 21. Paul is here speaking to the elders of Ephesus. They've met him on the island of Miletus. And he's saying unto them what he had been doing. He said he'd been testifying both to Jews and also to Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. So this is the text Ellen White's drawing her inspiration upon here. But we exercise, she says, repentance toward God, that is the Father. Why? Because it is His law that has been transgressed. And faith in Christ, His atoning sacrifice. So we have repentance toward God and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Continuing, she says, thus he obtains remission of sins that are past and becomes a partaker of the divine nature. He is a child of God, having received the spirit of adoption, whereby he cries, Abba, Father. Now, the Bible does speak a lot about what we would maybe call sanctification. Sanctification is the work of a lifetime, we are told. And I think we'll see that it is a progressive work. But in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, if we could turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and we have a very, very short verse here. Verse 3. He says, for this is the will of God, even your sanctification. And says that you should abstain from fornication, but of course we should abstain from all false things, all sin. But it is God's will that we be sanctified. In chapter 5, in verse 23, he says, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, we think of the spirit and the body making the soul. And Paul seems to be putting them together as different things here. And I'd like to propose to you that Paul is trying to write in such a way to include the ultimate totality of humanity so that there's no misunderstanding that there's nothing left out in what God wants to do to sanctify you. Because he said in that verse that the God of peace sanctify you wholly. Now, how does God generally work in this sanctification process? What does he use to bring sanctification to us? Well, in John chapter 17 and verse 17, notice what Jesus said. Jesus says, and is Jesus a good authority on this?
Yes.
Okay, I agree. He says, sanctify them. He's speaking to the Father, his high priestly prayer, speaking about his disciples, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Is there power in the word of God to do sanctification in our lives, friends? And Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12, it says, for the word of God is powerful. Powerful, it means it's full of power. There's power in the word of God to sanctify us. Romans 15 verse 16. Romans 15 verse 16. Paul says, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. He says that they're sanctified by the Holy Spirit. But in John chapter 16, verse 13, Jesus says that the work of the Spirit is to guide us into what? All truth. And Jesus said his word, God's word, is truth. The law is a transcript of God's character. And as we live in obedience to that law, we form characters in harmony with it. I want you to remember that. If we could go to our next slide in the upward look, page 89, paragraph 5. She says, never forget, maybe we might be prone to forget, never forget that thoughts work out actions. Let me just pause there. Thoughts work out actions. Don't forget that. This is one of the reasons that we are told in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, is at verse 4, it says that we are to bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, because thoughts work out actions. Never forget that thoughts work out actions. Repeated actions form habits, and habits form character. Then giving attention to the little things, there's no fear that the larger things will become stained and corrupted. So remember, friends, we begin our walk by faith, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. We continue our walk by faith, Colossians chapter 2, verse 6. And we walk like Jesus walked. Isn't that right?
Amen.
In John chapter 15, verse 10, Jesus tells us how he walked. Jesus says, if ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have what? Kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Same book, John chapter 8, verse 29. And he that sent me is with me. Oh, did Jesus say something about the one who sent, that the work of God is to believe on the one whom he has sent, right? We read that in John chapter 6, verse 29. But now here in John chapter 8 and verse 29, he says, and he that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone, for I do always those things that please him. In the Great Controversy, on the next slide on page 469 in paragraph 2, it says, the followers of Christ are to become like him by the grace of God to form characters in harmony with the principles of his holy law. This is Bible sanctification. Friends, we cannot form characters in harmony with anything else and go to heaven. That is the only place that we can form characters like. We are to cooperate with God. In Philippians chapter 2, Philippians 2, 12 and 13. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Oh, but I'm glad he doesn't stop there. Verse 13. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. He says we're to work out our own salvation, but how are we going to do that when we can't do anything apart from him? Well, we don't do anything apart from him. We do it with him. He comes in, he works in our lives, but friends, he won't come in unless we give him our will and allow him to do that. We open up our hearts to him. We surrender to him and submit to him to allow him to come in. Hey, I've got this tobacco habit, or I've got this dietary habit. You know, I mean, it's easy to look down on those things and make them issue. But it could be an anger problem, a temper problem. It could be all kinds of things. If I don't surrender that to the Lord Jesus Christ and give it to him, God can't help me. But if I will turn it over to Him and allow Him to come in and work in my heart, then there's nothing. There is nothing that He cannot help us with. Everything will fall perfectly into line. Now, it's true. We are told that at times the Christian will feel the promptings of sin. But he will maintain a constant warfare against it. Here's where Christ's help is needed. Human weakness becomes united with the divine strength, and faith exclaims, "Thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." 1 Corinthians 15:57. There's a story told of an Irishman that had a boat. And this boat had two oars. And in one oar, the word faith. And on the other oar, he had carved in the word works. And someone said, "What does that mean? Why did you do that?" And he says, "Well, I will show you." And so he got in the boat, and he took the one that said faith, and he started to row with just the one oar on the one side. And if you've ever been in a boat, you know exactly what happened. He went around a circle. So then he got the other oar that said works, and he started using it, and the boat went around just in the other direction. He says, "But let me show you what happens when I use them both together." And of course, the boat went forward. And perhaps that story was where Ellen White took her inspiration to write that faith and works are two oars which we must use equally if we would press our way up the stream against the current of unbelief. So this sanctification, it is a progressive work in our lives. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 31, he says, "I die daily." His death to self wasn't something that he just did one time when he was converted, and then he never had to die to self after that. In Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 1, here we have a text that clearly indicates, again, salvation, the process of sanctification is a progressive issue. He says here in Hebrews 6:1, "Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God." Philippians chapter 3, another verse. Philippians 3:13 and 14, Paul says, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." Paul said, "I'm just pressing forward. I'm not done yet, but I'm pressing forward." 2 Peter chapter 1, another text on this progressive thing. 2 Peter chapter 1, you know this series of texts that sometimes we call Peter's ladder. In verse 5, he says, "Besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue." Remember last week we read, faith must not be everything because I have to add something to it. "Add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness," and so on down the line. So beloved, if you feel you've not arrived yet, it's because you haven't. That's why we're still here. None of us have been translated yet. But we are pressing forward. We're pressing forward. And we're trying to get a little further along every day. And we're trusting in God for His help to do that. And as we progress, the further we progress, the greater will be our sense of humility and nothingness. I remember what Job said in Job 42 and verse 6. He says, "Wherefore I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes." Isaiah, you remember when he saw visions of God in Isaiah chapter 6, he says, "Well, I'm a man of undone lips, unclean lips." He just thought he was nothing. And yet, if we really are progressing, we will understand our humility and what we should be, and there will be no boasting of sinlessness. In Job chapter 9 and verse 20, "If I justify myself, mine own mouth shall condemn me. If I say I am perfect, it shall also prove me perverse." And does anybody remember what John wrote in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 8? 1 John chapter 1 and verse 8. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. And I believe that these texts are part of the basis for some statements that Ellen White made, and I'm just going to go ahead and share one of those statements now. She says, none of the apostles and prophets ever claimed to be without sin. Men who have lived the nearest to God, men who would sacrifice life itself rather than knowingly commit a wrong act, men whom God has honored with divine light and power, have confessed the sinfulness of their nature. They have put no confidence in the flesh, have claimed no righteousness of their own, but have trusted wholly in the righteousness of Christ. And then in Great Controversy, she says, and the claim to be without sin is in itself evidence that he who makes this claim is far from holy. It is because he has no true conception of the infinite purity and holiness of God, or of what they must become who shall be in harmony with his character. Because he has no true conception of the purity and exalted loveliness of Jesus and the malignity and evil of sin, that man can regard himself as holy. The greater the distance between himself and Christ, and the more inadequate his conceptions of the divine character and requirements, the more righteous he appears in his own eyes. This work that God wants to do for us, it is a whole work. Remember we read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, he says, and the God of peace shall sanctify you, how?
Holy.
Holy. Body, soul, and spirit. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 11. He says, dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7, 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1, he says, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Did I leave something out of that verse? Are you sure? What did I leave out? Of the flesh. He says, and I quote him again, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness. I suppose that must mean holiness in the flesh and spirit in the fear of God. Some of you wonder why I'm so crazy about this stuff of trying to eat right and get out and get some exercise. But what does the text say? The text says that we're to take care of ourselves and we are to offer unto God a living sacrifice in Romans chapter 12, and he says it is our reasonable service. Friends, don't think you can have true sanctification unless you're willing to have all the sanctification God wants you to have. Because according to Revelation chapter 21, verse 27, nothing that defiles is going to enter that holy city. But as we noted earlier, that if we have real faith, it will work, and it will work by love. It will purify our souls. It will prove that we have true faith. I could have a car sitting in the parking lot. I was getting gasoline yesterday afternoon before Sabbath. And a gentleman drove up in a 1986 Monte Carlo Super Sport. Really beautiful car, Andy. Had these big black tires on it. Cream white paint. Little red lettering on it. Vroom, 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 you know. How do you know it really will do that, you know? How do you know it really will perform? You know it will perform by the work it does, by how fast it goes out and what it can do. We can you know, build a model to look just exactly like it and doesn't even have an engine inside. And you can say, this is a fast car, but how do you prove it? You have to get it on the road, put it in gear. How do we prove we're really Christians? Friends, we need to get out in the world, and the field is the world. Exercise our faith. Well, there's a lot more we could talk about, but I know we're already running quite late. Two chapters in the book, are they found? Revelations 2 and 3. The first church is Ephesus.
Smyrna.
You better get the second one. Ephesus, Smyrna.
Thyatira.
Pergamos. Thyatira. Sardis.
Philadelphia.
Laodicea. Every one of those churches, Jesus, in the first or the second verse that he addresses these churches, every one of them, he begins by saying, I know thy works. I want to assure you, each one of us today, Jesus says, I know thy works. He knows whether our works spring from proud hearts striving to earn salvation, or even maybe from fearful hearts that believe that they must earn their way to salvation. But he also knows, friends, if our works are hot works of love and service because we are saved and we want to serve him. In Steps to Christ on page 61, it says, we do not earn salvation by our obedience, for salvation is the free gift of God to be received by faith, but obedience is the fruit of faith. Beloved, God doesn't want you to live like orphans, but as his children, but obedient children. Obedient children of faith. He wants us to be filled with all the fullness of God. And through the merits of Christ, we have access to the throne of infinite power. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 32, Paul says, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? The Father gave his Spirit without measure to his Son, and we may also partake of its fullness. Notice what Jesus said in John 14, verse 14. John 14, 14. Jesus says, if ye ask anything in my name, I will do it. And then in chapter 16 and verse 24, he says, hitherto have ye asked nothing in my name. Ask and ye shall receive, that your joy may be full. In the Great Controversy on page 477, while the Christian's life will be characterized by humility, it should not be marked with sadness and self-deprecation. It is the privilege of everyone so to live that God will approve and bless him. It is not the will of our Heavenly Father that we should be ever under condemnation and darkness. There is no evidence of true humility in going with head bowed down and the heart filled with thoughts of self. We may go to Jesus and be cleansed and stand before the law without shame and remorse. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit, Romans 8:1. I like that, don't you? On Wednesday, I was running up on the mountain, and I was listening to this text in Great Controversy. I was listening to the chapter that this reference comes from. I thought, oh, that's so good, because, you know, I'm so tempted to do that and to be like this oftentimes. And then about 5 minutes later, I fell down, and I scuffed up my hand and really took a hard hit. I tripped on a rock or something, and I was running pretty good and had a backpack on and fell down. But I remembered what this said. You know, and although it hurt, I got up and just kept going, because, you know, even in the things that are physical sometimes, the mind and the body, they cooperate, don't they? And this reference, it helped me. Beloved, through Jesus, we can become one with God. Our lives as Christians, they should be, as the old song says, joy unspeakable and full of glory. And as we behold the love and glory of the God, we will become changed into his image. Turn with me to Psalms 1, the first psalm. And notice the first three verses with me, please. Psalms 1, verses 1 through 3. It says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. And let me ask you a question before I go on. Does that sound more like what we do or what we believe?
What we do.
It sounds like what we do. But remember, friends, that the things that we think produce actions, and the actions produce habits, and the habits produce the characters. The only way we're going to be doing these things is if we have our minds fixed upon God first. Don't think you can have it any other way. Don't think you can have it of your own self. It has to come by grace through faith. Verse 2, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And that person, the psalmist says, shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper." And to close, in the Great Controversy on page 478, paragraph 3, "It is only as the law of God is restored to its rightful position that there can be a revival of primitive faith and godliness among his professed people. Thus saith the Lord, stand ye in the ways, and see and ask for the old paths, where is the good way, and walk therein, and ye shall find rest unto your souls." Jeremiah 6:16. God add his blessing to the reading of his word. May we learn what it means in a very practical sense to understand that we are to live by grace through faith. Just as we receive the Lord Jesus by grace through faith, we are to live by grace through faith, but that faith works, and it works by love and purifies the souls. And when we take those two great oars of faith and works, and we use them together, friends, God will bless our lives, we will become the people that he wants us to be, and we will be like that person mentioned in Psalms 1. Yes. May God bless us each.